Hello, Shirley Adams here with the Sewing Connection, Series 8, Program 13. Grunge is great in the eyes of some, mostly very young eyes. It's throwing the worst mismatches together for a much-used thrift shop look, when in fact it may be all brand new. I'm reversing that process here by taking something old and recycling it, not only into something new, but something that looks rich and opulent to be worn for a dressy and festive occasion. It's the scarf that I'm wearing. This all started out with one scarf. I was seeing this in a department store. There was a table there of their sale things. Originally, I don't know what the price of this had been, but the price tag I saw on it was less than $10. Now, that was because it was a little worn looking, and it was a little frayed around the edges, and the hem was puckered and pulled. It looked dreadful, but something about that kept saying, hey, take a second look, there's something here. You can do something with this, and I thought, for that money, why not? So I bought the scarf and brought it home, and I decided I wasn't going to use it as a scarf because it looked, as I said, pretty ratty. I was going to make it as a jacket, just put a little something under it to beef it up somewhat, an underlayer, and then make a jacket. Now, this was a big scarf. It was a 45-inch scarf, the same as the one that I have here in my hands. And as I laid out this scarf on the table, and got out a little suit pattern because, you know, 45 inches isn't a whole lot. 45 inch fabric, just getting that much of it, that's not much. How are you going to make a jacket out of that? And I thought, I can do it. I really can somehow. So I started out with a little jacket instead of a big one. So here's the little jacket I used that I've used repeatedly throughout this series and the last couple. What I did first of all is decide I don't want that point coming out, so I folded that under. And I also want just a short jacket, so I folded it under somewhere around the waist so it would just be like this. But even though I made this smaller, I could still put this any way I wanted to. I'll go ahead and fold this in half because typically you lay your pattern on fabric that's folded in half. And I thought, I can lay this pattern. Well, here we have a fold, so we better put the back over here, maybe. And then maybe let's put the front over here. And then what are we going to do with the sleeves? No way. There's just no way. You can play with this forever, and it's a jigsaw puzzle that you're not going to solve. You're not going to get all these pieces on in their entirety. Well, I was looking through a magazine about this time, and I came upon this picture. And I thought, look at that. It has a little shine to it. It looks very much like it could be my jacket just made into this. Now, I'm sure this is a very, very expensive outfit, but it hit me as I looked at this. Of course, cut it up, add a little bit of extra fabric to it if necessary, and just reassemble it and see what we can do that way. We might be able to work it out. So I'm going to show you in miniature how that actually did work, and you can do it too, perhaps, to something. Okay, this pattern I don't need, but I am going to use a smaller scarf because I'm doing this on a smaller scale. So to scale, it works out the same. Here's the scarf I'm going to use. And so because this is about half the size of the jacket, I'll also use a half size pattern. And this looks very much like the scarf that I had. Now this was not a striped scarf that I bought at all. Here's a little scrap left over from it. And you can see there are no stripes in this. I made the stripes by putting the pieces together. So this was the original scarf. So if I take also a little half size pattern, let's think what we can do with that. What I did first of all is cut out my pattern pieces in back, front, and sleeves. I didn't bother with facings or anything. I just lined it right out to the edge. So with that lining coming to the edge and a little lining left over maybe, I could put that in with the rest of the fabric if need be, since it went together nicely. But what I did first was cut all this out in a mounting fabric. Now, a couple of good choices for this would be what I actually used in here is, I'm looking for it, here it is, a little piece of clothing fleece, and I have used to it a little interfacing for around the edges so that it stiffens it somewhat. But this is what I've actually used inside this jacket. An equally good choice would be what I have down here on the table, all cut out already in miniature form. And this is cotton flannelette. So it's just, it's been washed several times in hot water to shrink it, to get it down to size. But this is done beautifully in so many garments these days, and it works very nicely. So what I did first of all was lay out my pattern pieces. And what I wanted to do, because I've told you before in former series, the way to match plaids and stripes so that they work every time and you cannot go wrong, is to match the underarm points. And that's what I'm getting together right here, the underarm points. That's here on the front and here on the sleeve and here on the back. And this sleeve I'll put over here and put the other front over here. And if I would just lay this pattern and get those pieces lined up on this mounting fabric with all the underarm points there together, I'm going to have a stripe that matches perfectly and you can't go wrong. So here are my pattern pieces. I also realized I'm going to have to cut them a little bit. So here's how I cut them. I already have the lines drawn on here. I decided an easy place to cut would be right at that notch because it's going to be in the same place, front and back. So that notch would be right about here probably where I have this extra stripe, which is the lining fabric. So this is where I cut everything. Right along there, so back and back, I have those two pieces to lay, and front, and then the sleeve was extra long, so I had to cut it in about three pieces. And then it's a matter of getting all those pieces worked out on this. Again, it's putting together a jigsaw puzzle and seeing what'll work. But this is fun to do. You're recycling something for which you have no use because it's over the hill or you're just tired of it in its present form. For whatever reason, you're recycling it. So it's not a gamble. It isn't as though you're working with expensive fabric that you must make work. Whatever turns out, fine. We get potluck here and it might be just terrific. So with these pieces I have, first of all, there's a fold. We better get the back along that fold because it has to be there, so I'll do that. And I want to utilize what little border I have here at the same time, so I'll put the bottom of it right at the edge so that I can get that border in place. And then I'm going to put the other back on, of course, somewhere else here along this fold since it was also cut on the fold. And then let's think what we want to do with the fronts. I want that border, what little bit there is on my scarf. And here's what border I have left, so I'll show it to you. There wasn't a whole lot of border on this. As you can see, I've utilized this border right here. And so I just wanted to use a corner of it so the border would come out right. This is a mind game, really, is what we're doing when we do this. It keeps you alert. It keeps you from getting all cobwebby up there and see what you can do. So, okay, this one I want to put down here. And this one's going to fit here just fine. And then I still have the top of the front. That might fit, oh, about here. If I'd put the other back here, this one would fit here. So I'll get it. I'm watching the grain arrows, so I want everything on grain, so it's going to work out right. But I'll put this one over here, and I'll put the back as close to it as possible because I'm going to need all I can get, probably. So the back goes here. All I have left is the three sleeve pieces. Well, let's take care of the major part first. I'll put it right here in the middle, and that ought to work out right. And then those two big corners I have left, goodness, I can surely get the rest of the sleeve to fit there. Now, all this sleeve may not necessarily be on the same grain as the whole jacket is, not on the same grain. The back's going sideways. The front and the sleeve is mainly going up and down. This part of the sleeve, though, is going to have to go sideways, and that's okay. We can live with that. If it's a little bit off grain, it isn't going to make that much difference. This is fitting a little tightly here. I'd have to put it somewhere else. I'm not at this time going to cut out the sleeve. I'm just going to cut out some of it to show you exactly how I did this. I'm going to fudge a little on the maybe the bottom so I can get the sleeve on too. Well, whatever. We'll worry about the sleeve another time. Okay, what I want to cut out here though is the front especially and show you how that's laid. And then you can just assume the back and the sleeves were laid the very same way so that they'd all work out fine. Okay, front and front. These are the two pieces I really want just to show how they're laid out. And then I'll show you how we put it all together so that it works. Okay, so with this front cut out here, and very soft scarf here, so it moves around a little bit. To have that mounting fabric really helps. Now, of course, you could do it without the mounting. You could just do it so that it's lightweight and floaty like a scarf is, but it helps to have that mounting fabric so that there's something to stitch it down to. That's what made this a really easy job, actually. Okay, we've got a front there, and here's another front, and we'll see if they all go together then and fit on that. And if we have any problems at all, we can always add to it a little bit here or there. Okay, here's my front and front. So unpin it and see what we've got. Okay, this one is going up here on the sleeve area. Was this it? No, this was it. Was this it? Yes, like this is going to work out just fine. And then this one will go over on this side in the same manner. And then you realize I'd put the backs and so on down in the same way so that they'd all work out. But these fronts with their borders now is what I'm going to put down in the front corner of the jacket, down here, and again over on the other side. And this scarf is probably proportionately a little bit bigger, fits the pattern a little bit better than my scarf actually did, because I could almost make it with this, not quite. So what I did then is just add some of the lining pieces. So to this, I put a lining piece here and overlap the scarf on top, because you can see through. What I'm going to cover up these edges with is this. Now, as I said, I spent somewhere between $5 and $10 for this scarf. I have no idea what I spent for the rest of it. I went back to my local fabric shop and I found this very unusual ribbon, whatever it is, I don't even know, but it's something I had never seen before. The scarf that I used came from India. This looked like it was in keeping with it. The color was right, but it's a see-through ribbon. It's very, very thin. And I thought, since I'm going to be able to see through this ribbon, I want to have the print fabric on top and just use the base fabric, the lining fabric, down there where I must. So I kind of did it like this. I don't want too much showing. I'll do it the opposite way in this case, and put the lining fabric over the top so that you can see there's a stripe in there later on. Okay, so after I put it on like this, and probably put lots of pins there, or go ahead and baste it if you want to, whatever it takes. I just put pins wherever I needed them. And after I had everything nicely pinned in place, then it was going over to the machine and just covering those raw edges with the braid and making a stripe in the process of doing so. Now, originally, I bought about 5 yards of this ribbon, not having any idea how much I was going to need. 5 yards isn't going to do it. If you put as many stripes on as I have here, I think I actually used 20 yards of it is what it took. So I had to take another trip back and get it. But you don't necessarily know when you start out what you're going to be using. So it may just take that second trip to get it all in gear. Okay, so this is how it was. I'm going to cut off this little extra here. Just sort of casually, I can give it a better haircut later on. Okay, and then go over the machine and do some stitching. Now, first of all, what I wanted to do, of course, is get those raw edges covered with this ribbon. So this is why I only had 5 yards to begin with, thinking, oh, that's going to be plenty to cover the raw edges. But after I put that ribbon on, and I thought, you know, I really like the look of that. And then I looked at that magazine clipping and thought, yeah, I like all those stripes. That'd work out so nicely with this. That's when I had to go back and get a whole lot more ribbon to build the stripes. So anyway, it was just putting a few pins in to get this ribbon right in place. Take the pins out as you come to them. So I'll put a couple more in here to get it all placed down. And what's nice about this, of course, ravelly edges on these fabrics, terribly ravelly, but they certainly aren't going to do any raveling once they're all covered with the ribbon. Even though they are on top and kind of show, there's no way they're going to ravel, so you don't have to worry about them. So now, if you can't get ribbon like this, which I haven't seen anywhere else, I just lucked onto it. You know, every once in a while, serendipity just works for you, and you're a nice person and you deserve it, don't you? So if I hadn't been able to get this, then I possibly would have used some hem tape or some hem lace. Whatever you can find in the trim department of the store, just look through it and see what's available. So I'd put another one over here when I'm doing the stitching on this one. and then just straight stitch down each side. There was no reason to do anything elaborate. There was no reason to make these a little bit bigger. There was no reason to satin stitch the edge since the braid was not going to, or the ribbon, was not going to ravel. So I simply did a straight stitch right along the edge to hold it all in place. Get this pin out. And then, as typically happens, I kind of get carried away. You know, I get this far, get the ribbon down, and think, boy, isn't that fun? Let's just make a few more stripes. So that's when the return trip resulted. I think that if I didn't have a problem, sewing wouldn't be half the fun as it is, but I really like to solve those problems and see what it takes to turn something that's an absolute disaster into something that actually works. Okay, so there's one down, and see how nicely it covers. Everything works out just fine. We can put it over the rest. And then after we have a few of those stripes, you'll see why I just couldn't resist putting some more on. I'll turn it the other way since I have the pins going the other direction and just sort of remove as I go. But this is easy sewing. This jacket didn't actually take that long. And what was nice about it also is the fact that if it completely bombed, I would have thrown it out without any regrets because I would have learned a lot on it, so it was well worth the time spent. I would have created some new ideas, and if I didn't like it, so what? Big deal. Okay, and do the other side of this, and then let's see about a few stripes. And there's another one, and now for the stripes. This is about the time when I thought, yeah, stripes would be more effective on it. They'd give more impact instead of just these few stripes. So the next stripe I put down was thinking, how about something right along here, this heavy braid? Because I had also bought this braid when I was in the store. And it's one that has this round braid on the edge, and then there's a flat braid, a ribbon, that you can use to stitch down. So I put this right down here. And ordinarily you would put this between layers, which I did on this jacket. It's between the edge of the jacket and the lining or the facing down there before I hem the lining a little shorter. So I did put this there, but I also wanted some here just to accent that border a little bit more. So some of this is raveling. I'll cut off that end and just put this down here. And of course I can't conceal it in anything here the way I could if I would be doing this along the lower edge between a facing. There are no seams here. This is just going to be top stitched in place. So it's thinking, what can I do about it? Again, back to that nice little transparent ribbon is what I did. Not only did I pin this down, and I don't remember if I did it in a separate process or all at one time, but here's where I used some more of that ribbon just to cover this black braid because that wasn't decorative, that's utilitarian. And so I needed a little bit more. Now I'm remembering that I also had to, and I should have thought about it in advance this time, I also had to rip out a couple stitches right here to tuck this raw edge under the tape so that it wouldn't show. So I did that also. What I'm going to do here is just move this up so that you will realize later on I would actually get rid of some of those stitches, so that I could tuck the raw ends underneath and get them all buried away, safely concealed. Okay, so let's just stitch a little bit of this down, and I'm going to be stitching close to this cord. That's not easy to do with this all-purpose presser foot that I have here, so I'm going to need something that I can get close to the cord with. Maybe it's going to be a zipper foot, maybe a piping foot, which I don't have in here, so I'll just use the zipper foot instead, just so I can come close to that cord, but this is what I would have used then to put that cord on. So get the zipper foot over. The needle's going to go in between the cord and the foot, therefore I'm putting the foot over on this side. And I just need to do this stitching so it's kind of close to it here. You might want to change needle position if it would work out better so that you could get closer. I didn't bother here, but you might want to move it over to the right side a little bit more and get closer. This seems to work all right without doing that. And then when you get down to the corner, you're going to have to do a little bit of turning. And you can't turn all this very easily without doing a little clipping first. So as we come down here to the corner, about here probably, I'll get it up out of the way and get this other pin out. And I'm going to clip. And the reason is because this would be too stiff, this braid that's underneath the ribbon. This would be too stiff, really, to try to turn a corner here and you'd have all that bulk. So it would be a good idea instead to just clip the black braid, not the cord. I'm just going to clip the black braid here so that I can turn the corner. Come on, clip right to the edge. Be sure that you have a pair of scissors that will clip right to the point, which these did. And then I can turn this. And I'll probably want to miter this ribbon as I turn it. So it would have been a good idea to do this before I got right to the corner, but it'll work this way. I can get it done. Okay, I'll just put a pin in here to hold it temporarily so that I can then take a couple more stitches, turn the corner, and we'll be home free. One will do the job. Okay, and then we just come down here. I, of course, when I made the jacket, put a lot more pins in so that it would come out perfectly everywhere, so that I didn't do anything this quickly, carelessly. But you can see how easily this is going to work. And then after I got this all finished and stitched, rather crookedly in this case, after I got this finished, this is when I decided then, let's do some other stripes. So in addition to what I already have here, and before I put the other edge of this ribbon down, this was the time then to put several ribbons in place and make the stripes. So I would just put all these down and pin them where I wanted them and do several rows of this. And anyway, you can see how all this stripe came about. Okay? So after I had these pinned down and perhaps stitched, probably stitched also, then I did this one last, this edge last, so that it would cover everything up. Then of course around all the outside edges, you'd have maybe a facing cut, or as I said, I just cut the lining right to the edge here and didn't even have a facing, but I did stitch this braid down to the outer edge of the jacket all the way around. And the way to stitch that, of course, because it's going to be covered up and because the black flat braid is going to be included in your seam allowance, but this is going to be showing this pretty cord that's all twisted there. Because of that, I want to put it on in this position. I'd want the braid toward the outside and the cord toward the inside and just get all this pinned in place. And then when I put the facing down on top and stitch around and it's turned to the back side, then the cord comes out like this. Isn't this really a job that you could do if you felt so inclined? So this is how this jacket came about. And I'm just so pleased when I can make something out of nothing, just because it's fun and I like to do that. Well, not only did I make this jacket, which turned out very easily, but we have another jacket. And Debbie over here is modeling another one. And what this one is that Debbie has on is actually three scarves that I had left. Debbie, you want to come over a little closer? And you can see this is a long jacket, so here's the pattern I used. And because actually these scarves, you're not going, a 36-inch scarf is what I had for each of these, three 36-inch scarves. You're not going to, in a big jacket like this certainly, cut out all that easily. It's going to have to either be a patchwork or something. What I did with this jacket is decide, for one thing, it's absolutely shapeless. It's just a straight jacket. So I first of all just overlapped the pattern pieces like this and made it one piece. So that when I was cutting out these pieces that Debbie's wearing, you can see here this one scarf that's over here. There's the border. I utilized that border. I first of all started though with this scarf and have the border going all around. And I could mainly do that all the way around until I got, can we turn you around, Debbie? Right at the bottom here, I'll lift this up so you can see it. Right at the bottom, I had to piece it. I had to cut it out of the opposite side a little bit to get that finished all the way around. And then the other two scarves too. Here and back, I thought, let's just put one point down there and finish it up that way. And then let's cut off some of the others in different ways. But it's just three scarves that I had no use for, and they were all kind of in the same color family. And it's, let's do something fun with it, is what happened. Well, this series, and thanks, Debbie, for showing us the scarf. Oh, before she goes, I also put a lining in this. I hemmed them separately because it's just floaty, loose scarves, and I wanted them to hang gracefully here. But anyway, this lining is kind of heavy because it gives it some weight, some ballast, which it really needed. So, kind of fun. Oh, I did have a few scraps left. That's what Debbie's wearing there for a blouse. What was left over from the three scarves just made that little blouse. Now, I didn't have a whole lot left from any of these. Here are the remains of those three scarves in Debbie's jacket. Here are the remains of the one scarf in my jacket. Not a whole lot left, but a fun project, and I enjoyed doing it. Now, thanks, and we'll let you go, Debbie. Well, we started this series out in India with this jacket you see hanging back here on the rack, with Indian silks and Indian elephants down there, and we've ended up in India. What this series was an appreciation of several other cultures other than our own, because it is so nice to look around the world and see what everybody else has to offer. It started in India, as I said. It ended in India, where these scarves were produced, even though these aren't Indian influences in the way they're put together. And I've just really enjoyed sewing with you this series. And I'm going to look forward to connecting again real soon. Series 9 is already in the works, so please write your public television station to be sure they tape it free of charge from satellite, and we'll meet right here for the Sewing Connection, Series 9, your connection to the world of fashion. Enjoy.